In the year 1980, something exciting arrived in America.
The Star Wars saga continues in The Empire Strikes Back.
No, not that.
For you, Xanadu.
No, getting colder.
NBC News now makes its projection for the presidency.
Oh, good God. I said something exciting. Yes, that was it. For the first time ever, the character of Captain Harlock would appear in an English-language production, courtesy of none other than B-movie legend Roger Corman.
Your imagination is the final destination on the Galaxy Express.
The 1979 film Galaxy Express 999 had been acquired by New World Pictures and was redubbed into English for theatrical distribution in the United States, at a time when most Americans had never even heard of Japanese animation, much less seen any in their local theater. But as with many things being attempted for the first time, there were inevitable snags.
A beginning is a very delicate time.
In America at the time, animated film equaled Disney, whose most recent animated film at the time was The Rescuers. A film like Galaxy Express 999, shortened to simply Galaxy Express, must have been baffling for all involved.
A young boy journeys into space, into time, and into manhood.
It's not a fairy tale. There are no knights saving princesses. There are no talking animals. It's a tale of class warfare that feels more like the work of a space-age Charles Dickens than anything from the Mouse House. The protagonist is a street orphan whose mother was murdered right in front of his eyes by a rich cyborg man who kills regular humans for sport. Sure, Bambi's mom may have gotten shot under similar circumstances, but Bambi didn't eventually find his mom's stuff and mount it on a wall, even though that's the sort of thing a deer would be more likely to encounter. The plot follows his quest for vengeance upon his mother's killer, and instead of any homilies about the value of forgiveness or how violence is never the answer, the story puts a gun in his hands and gives him advice such as,
"If and when you do find Count Mecha, shoot him before he has a chance."
Which turns out to be pretty good advice. It also features a train flying through space and a lot of other Western trappings, which must have been novel for anyone seeing the film a quarter century before Firefly invented the space Western. And it was this relative novelty, perhaps, that caused its American producers to seize upon the Western aspects with a bit too much enthusiasm. So the first time Americans heard the character of Captain Harlock speak in their native tongue,
"Bartender, bring a glass of milk."
It was a bit of unintentional comedy.
"Just like John Wayne."
"Damn right, just like John Wayne. What's wrong with that?
Greatest American that ever lived."
And it didn't help that he was introduced to those audiences as,
"Why, you're Captain Warlock."
"That's one bonehead name."
And he wasn't the only one. Tochiro Oyama became Sundown McMoon, and our hero, Tetsuro Hoshino, became Joey... Yeah, I'll let him tell you.
"It's Joey Hanakana Baba Commander Smith."
Yeah. Though, on the other hand, Emeralda's got to keep her name, minus the S. The villain, Queen Prometheum, got to keep hers, minus the M. And the antagonist, whose name literally translated to the Mechanical Count, was given the moniker of Count Mecha, a translation which was retained for almost all future English versions, both official and amateur, a precedent which held true for another character as well, which I'll discuss shortly. In those days, on productions such as this, no one seemed to bother with credit. Numerous voice actors are listed, but with no indication as to who voiced whom. I think we can say with confidence that the first listed B.J. Ward played the voice of Joey, as her roles in series such as Jana of the Jungle leave little doubt.
"The last thing I remember was traveling up the Great River with my father.
Please tell me when he'll be here. Do you know when he's going to land?"
As for the others, it's quite hard to be certain, but the remaining voice talent included the voice of Furby, a Vegas singer most known for a 12 Days of Christmas parody, the narrator for Closet Cases of the Nerd Kind,
"What are Closet Cases of the Nerd Kind?"
and that guy who got his dick shot off by Pam Grier in Coffee. Yeah, you do not want to fuck with Pam Grier. The script was a pretty straight translation and conveyed the story accurately, at least for those portions of the film that actually made it to the English version. The two-hour 999 film was reduced to 94 minutes, which meant that nearly a quarter of the picture was gone. Most of the cutting involved secondary characters such as Harlock and his compatriots, who would have been familiar to Japanese audiences through the Space Pirate series that was still in the air when this film came out, but who wouldn't have been as meaningful to American viewers. Unfortunately, cutting some but not all of their scenes only served to make their appearances even more confusing and lacking in motivation. Tetsuro talked early in the film about his admiration for Harlock and Emeraldus. But in the New World dub, their appearances feel very unheralded. And what audience member could make sense of Sundown McMoon's final scene in the film without the deleted later scene where he reveals that his consciousness has been transferred to the computer aboard Harlock's ship? The story arc with Claire the waitress was also virtually eliminated, and her self-sacrifice to protect Tetsuro makes no appearance in Corman's version. Nevertheless, this early entry into the pantheon of Americanized Harlock properties is notable for setting two long-running trends into motion. One reasonably significant, the other completely unimportant but altogether weirder. Trend one, getting Mater's name wrong.
My name is Maytel.
Sorry, wrong. That should actually be Mater.
No more buttered scones for me, Mater. I'm off to play the grand piano.
I'll explain. The Japanese language has no true L sound. The spoken sound is somewhere between an R and an L. Whenever a non-Japanese word is spelled in their alphabet, the R is used in place of the L, which can sometimes cause trouble for translators. In the English dub of Vampire Hunter D, for example, the protagonist is referred to as...
He's a dampier.
When it should really be dampier, an actual word for a half-vampire that the translator obviously wasn't familiar with. In the case of names, context is important. One must consider what the original writer was likely trying to say. You could say with reasonable certainty that Harlock's spaceship wasn't really supposed to be the Alcadia. Consider. The character functions as a surrogate mother for the hero, and as we eventually discover, she's running around in the body of his actual mother. In the third Galaxy Express movie, a song sung in first person which illustrates the character's inner conflict is titled Mother. From this, one could reasonably deduce that Mater, the Latin word for mother, was the inspiration for the name, though, as it turns out, such speculations aren't even really necessary. Leiji Matsumoto, who created Galaxy Express 999, made this fact quite clear in the July 1996 issue of Animerica. Though that didn't stop Animerica's parent company, Viz Media, from using the Maytel spelling in their own subtitled and dubbed versions 3 years later, so pervasive was the convention by then. Much in the way that American fans had decided that the 1980s Dirty Pair feature was named Project Eden, a title which appears nowhere on the film itself but which does appear on the official US release, it became an unwritten rule that Maytel was the version of the name that would be used on all English versions, barring that one version done by our friends at Harmony Gold.
My name's Joey, I'm Catherine.
Who just had to do things their own way.
Ooh, your powers of deduction are exceptional.
I know what you're gonna say. The Japanese have spelled her name that way too. That's true, they have. But they've also spelled it with an R as well, much like they've also used both the spelling Harlock and Herlock to refer to the same character. Or how this computer display shows a command for a door to close right before one saying close. Perhaps the fact that there's only one correct way to spell any given sound with the Japanese alphabet makes all of these alternate spellings with the Roman alphabet seem rather arbitrary. It's worth noting that a character from the series Eureka 7, whose name is spelled the same in Japanese, is known as Mater in the English version of that show.
What is this? Bizarro World?
Of course, I don't expect this to actually change anyone's usage, as habit and tradition often command a much stronger hold than boring old facts, as evidenced by this more recent Matsumoto interview where, as he's clarifying the meaning of the name yet again, the interview translator still puts Maytel into his mouth as he's describing how it's the word for mother, even though Maytel isn't a word for mother. In all fairness, I should point out that he also stated that the name Deslar is actually supposed to be Death Ra from the English word death and the name of the Egyptian sun god. Which no one has adopted because, let's be honest, it sounds rather silly. But let's move on to the second trend begun by the New World dub.
No cats!
Whoever edited this film, i.e. these guys, seemed to have an issue with cats. This scene was cut short to get rid of this cat. This cat got cut out. This entire scene with Tochiro's mom got removed. There's a cat in her lap. A later, very brief scene of mom was cut. Same cat, same treatment. Okay, granted, this cat is rather silly, but seriously, what gives? In the mid-80s, Harmony Gold's attempt at an English version of the Space Pirate series took the episode wherein Dr. Zero tells the story of how he got his pet cat and shredded it until not a trace of the cat story remained. In 1987, Peregrine Films released a dub of My Youth in Arcadia, where they saw fit to cut this scene. Okay, people, that cat was on screen for a second and a half, but you thought it was worth the trouble to remove anyway. What do all these people have against kitties? If New World had dubbed Night on the Galactic Railroad instead of Galaxy Express, the movie would have been like 3 minutes long. What is this antagonism towards our feline friends? Comments? Opinions? Anyone? The film was eventually released to home video in 1984, because everything took forever in the 80s, and was the introductory version of the film for many. And despite its numerous foibles, it wasn't all bad. The English rendition of the Taking Off song, I think, is better than the original, which is so cheerful it feels out of place compared to the rest of the soundtrack. The English version, while retaining the same melody, feels appropriately downbeat. The version of Yuz's song is also nicely done, though it's a shame it's cut down so short. Totoro's voice is pretty good, and Emeraldus may have never been cast better.
No one ever pointed a gun at me and lived to tell about it.
What I said before about Pam Grier applies equally to this Emeraldus. I wish I knew who to thank. I also wish I knew who'd voiced Harlock for rather different reasons.
You want to kill him, is that it?
Nah, let's face it, the choice of a cheesy John Wayne impression probably wasn't the actor's idea.
Maybe his advisors are confused.
Harlock would have a hard slog ahead of him. Following this first appearance, he'd be dubbed with bad comedy.
Alien ETs who want to blackball the planet Earth!
Forced to share screen time with a totally unrelated show.
I'm not impressed.
Half his dialogue shifted to a 7-year-old girl via some spectacularly bad mastering.
Now let me see a smile.
Why did you come here? They're waiting to kill you.
Get a pretty decent dub that suffered from even more severe editing than Galaxy Express.
I'm just doing it to pay the rent.
Feature in a humdrum dub of a pretty humdrum series.
Stop complaining.
And finally, near the century's end, make a return engagement in a new dub of Galaxy Express.
There comes a time for a man when he must act.
Yes, and that time would be when he's in a recording booth voicing one of the most iconic and enduring animated heroes of all time.
You've got to act!
And things wouldn't get appreciably better in the coming years, either.
You must have been prepared for the worst.
It's disappointing that a character such as Captain Harlock has never been properly presented in the way he deserves in any American production. And to see the film containing his first appearance, a film as powerful and beautiful as Galaxy Express 999, dismissed as so-so by the American press, no doubt in part due to the cartoonish dubbing and egregiously confused editing, though it's in some ways worse to have critics make the downright factual error of comparing its quality to that of Saturday morning cartoons.
That's pretty rough, isn't it?
And basically demonstrates that Mr. Critic Guy has never actually sat down and watched an American Saturday morning cartoon in his entire life. While the constant ass-kissing Disney receives from stateside critics may be wrong-headed and frustrating, it remains a fact that Disney's dubs of Japanese animated films are far and away the best ones done thus far. They unfortunately have not included any films featuring Harlock. Regrettably, a fitting portrayal of Harlock in English has seemed perpetually out of reach since the attempts began. The New World ad campaign cheesily invoked the notion that your imagination is the final destination, or, to put it in a slightly different phrase, you ultimately just end up making believe that you got where you wanted to go. Maybe that's the best one can hope for in the case of a character whose foray into the English language got off on such a wrong foot.
Well, there's some things a man just can't run away from.